Good evening, and welcome to this year's Maundy Thursday service. It's been my pattern to recognize this evening in a tenebrae service of shadows and readings. It is our Presbyterian way to acknowledge that there is sin in the world, there is brokenness in the world. And while many in our culture don't like to sit close to darkness, preferring to be in the excitement and joy of the moment, we Presbyterians know that at times we have to sit on the edge of darkness. We have to grieve the sorrows of the world and share in the sins and losses of life. And so tonight we acknowledge the brokenness of people and the fallenness of the world and the grace of our God that cannot be stopped no matter what darkness falls upon us. As the service progresses, we'll extinguish a candle, we'll hear the story of Holy Night and Holy Week. Let us turn to God in prayer. Almighty and gracious Lord Jesus, we come before you on this night remembering your great love for us. For it was on this night that you poured out the water and washed the disciples' feet and commanded them to love one another as you have loved them. On this night, O Lord, you broke the bread and told of how your body would be broken. Your life would be poured out for us all. On this night, O Lord, we remember the betrayal and sin of our world, denial and anguish, sacrifice, suffering. We also know, O Lord, that you are with us through the darkness and loneliness of life, through the brokenness of our days and the sins of our decisions. Bless us, O Lord, now in this time, that we might connect with your Spirit and with one another. We offer this in the name of our Savior, Jesus the Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen. The story begins. Then came the day of unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. So Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, Go and prepare the Passover for us, that we may eat it. They said to him, Where will you have us prepare it? He said to them, Behold, when you have entered the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him into the house which he enters, and tell the householder, The teacher says to you, Where is the guest room where I am to eat Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large upper room, furnished. There make ready. And they went and found it as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. Gathered in the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas. and took counsel together in order to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. But he said, "Not during the feast, lest there be a tumult among the people." Then one of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said, "What will you give me if I deliver him to you?" And they paid him 30 pieces of silver. And from that moment, he sought an opportunity to betray him. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world, yet the world did not know him. The shadow of betrayal. Let us pray in confession. Holy and merciful God, in your presence we confess our sinfulness, our shortcomings, and our offenses against you. You alone know how often we have sinned, in wandering from your ways, in wasting your gifts, in forgetting your love. Have mercy on us, O Lord, for we are humbled by our sin and wholeheartedly seek to do what is right. Forgive us and help us to live in your light and walk in your ways, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Who is in a place to condemn us? Only Christ Jesus. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in glory over us. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Glory to God. The shadow of sacrifice. When it was evening, Jesus sat at table with his 12 disciples. And as they were eating, he said, "Truly, I say to you, one of you will betray me." And they were very sorrowful and began to say to him, one after another, "Is it I, Lord?" Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took a cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink it, all of you. For this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I shall not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people loved darkness rather than light. The shadow of sacrifice. As we prepare to share in communion tonight, I invite you to pause the video and to go and get some bread or juice to quiet your heart, to quiet your world, and to prepare to remember this solemn evening when Jesus was ready to die for you and for me. Let us pray. Holy Lord, on this night you broke bread. On this night you offered yourself. On this night, O Lord, you drank the cup. And though you would have preferred not, you drank the cup, knowing that your life brings us life, and that your death brings us new life. And so, O Lord Jesus, we pray that as we break the bread and drink this cup, your presence might be real in our lives, that your spirit might continue to resonate with our spirit, and that your voice would sing out through our lives and into your world. For we offer this in Christ's name. The Bible tells us that it was on the night of his arrest that Jesus took bread, and after thanking God, he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in memory of me." Friends, the body of Christ broken, that we who are broken might be made whole. Eat of it. Supper, Jesus took a cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of it, all of you." The mercy of our Lord poured out for us all. Denial. Then those who had seized Jesus led him to Caiaphas the high priest, and the scribes and the elders had gathered. But Peter followed him at a distance, as far as the courtyard of the high priest, and going inside, he sat with the guards to see the end. Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard, and a maid came up to him and said, "You also were with Jesus the Galilean." But he denied it before them all, saying, "I do not know what you mean." When he went out to the porch, another maid saw him, and she said to the bystanders, "This man was with Jesus of Nazareth." And again, he denied it with an oath, I do not know the man. After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter, Certainly, you're also one of them, for your accent betrays you. Then he began to invoke a curse on himself and to swear, I do not know the man. And immediately the cock crowed. And Peter, remembering the saying of Jesus, Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times. And he went out and he wept bitterly. If your eye is unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how great the darkness? The shadow of denial. Judgment. Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them, Which of the two do you want me to release for you? And they said, Barabbas. Pilate said to them, Then what shall I do with Jesus who is called the Messiah? All of them said, Let him be crucified. And he asked, Why? What evil has he done? But they shouted all the more, Let him be crucified. So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that the riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves. And the people as a whole answered, His blood be on us and on our children. So he released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. The shadow of judgment. We sometimes say, Life or death. A teenager is making plans to go out. And she explains to her mom, It's life or death, Mom. He's going to be there. I need to see him. A man explains to his boss, It's life or death. I've got to go watch the soccer game. We might be standing in line at a post office. We explain to the clerk, Now, look, it has to get there by Saturday. The package is for my grandson's birthday. It has to be there by Saturday, or my daughter's going to kill me. You don't understand. It's life or death. Life or death. And that's what we say. Too often, I think. We know when we say it, I guess, that it's just an exaggeration. It's just hyperbole, something we say for emphasis or impact. Still, there are probably times when we have felt like it was life or death. Times when we're late for work, zooming along the highway, now look, I can't be late one more day. And we hurried off to get to some event. Some of us are so time conscious that we get panicked if we're not going to be 5 minutes early. So being late is life or death. Life or death. Still, we probably don't say it when we should say it. A friend probably shouldn't be driving after the party. We've asked for his keys, we've asked him to call an Uber, but no, he didn't want to, and we didn't want to make a scene. It's not exactly life or death. Of course, unless it is life or death. A neighbor doesn't care about COVID, doesn't want to bother wearing a mask. It's just a hoax anyway. It's not like it's life or death. Until his mom is in the ICU. There are times when our decisions matter. Does the alcoholic take another drink? Does the faithful spouse leave the unfaithful spouse? Does the patient elect to have risky surgery that either will kill him or save his life? Life or death? There are times when our decisions matter, but we don't usually get it right. We usually make mountains out of molehills. We usually get all worked up over the smallest of things. And yet we consider insignificant some of the most important things. Life or death. On this evening, it seems to be in the front of our minds. Several of the characters that we see across the screen of Passion Week seem to have life or death choices. Life or death choices. And each character has to decide what they will do. It's either life for me or death. Well, consider. There's Caiaphas the high priest. He's the leader of the Jewish people, and he raises this question before the Jewish leadership, and he says to them, "You don't understand. It's better for one man to die for the people than to have the whole nation destroyed. Better one than us all, better him than me, better his life than my death. After all, it's life or death for somebody." And so Caiaphas makes it clear, it will be his death and our life. But he was not the only one to consider such a question. Perhaps Judas wrestled with that. My gain equals his loss. My success is failure. My triumph, his defeat. My living for another day is ending life today. We can hardly blame Judas, really. I mean, he perhaps didn't understand what he was getting in for. He just signed up to be faithful, just signed up to love God, just signed up to see the world and hear good news. He didn't know that his life might be on the line. He didn't know that his future, his success, his opportunities might be crushed with this man. How could he let all of it slip away? How could he let his life hang in the balance? Better him than me. When the choice was life or death, Judas chose his life, and so he betrayed Jesus. We understand. We don't always take this God stuff seriously. I mean, we like church, we like fellowship dinners, we like being connected, we like being cared for, but really, we're not sure we want to risk too much. Not sure we can risk embarrassing ourselves or telling people that we're Christians, or not sure that we really want to go out and worry about all those orphans and widows in the world when we have enough worries of our own. There's a lot of nice stuff in the way. Let's not push the stuff that's uncomfortable for us. Let's not push the stuff that makes me consider my life differently. And there were others who got caught up in this week and the struggle of power. They themselves were innocent, or at least as innocent as any that week. But still they got caught in the crosshairs and were forced to make a life or death choice. At least that's how it looks for Peter. Peter is trying to do the right thing, trying to be faithful, trying to stay with Jesus, and then he is caught. The accusers pointed him. He's one of them. Yes, you are. Yes, this is one of them. Hey, everybody, get over here. This is one of them. What was he to do? Surely God did not need two people to go to the cross that day. How could Peter tell everyone about Jesus? How could he tell about what had happened if his neck was on the line? It didn't really add to Jesus' death. He didn't really contribute. Still, he chose darkness. And there are times when we choose darkness. We don't create all the suffering of the world. We don't create all the problems. We don't put people out on the street or see that some don't get enough. But still, sometimes we turn away and deny. And our silence declares me, not them. And there were others who had an easier decision that week, and yet still they didn't make the right decision. The crowd gathered in front of Pilate, and Pilate offers them a choice. Jesus, prophet, mighty in word and deed, whom you call Messiah, or some criminal, some scoundrel, some insurrectionist. Surely the people could see. This was Jesus. Just days before, they had seen him ride into town. Just days before, they had proclaimed, "Hosanna, oh, save us." So why make this choice? Maybe they were angry, felt betrayed. They had expected Jesus to call 10,000 angels. They had expected angel armies to march through the streets and kick out the Romans. They had expected maybe the keys of the kingdom for them and the keys to hell for their enemies. For whatever reasons, they did not speak up. Perhaps it was out of fear. Look what they've done to this man. Look what they have done to this powerful man. Look what our leaders and others have done to this man. Best not get involved. Best go along. Keep your head down and say what they want you to say. Just do it. Whether out of spite or fear, it's a life or death choice. Our life is death. Better him than me. How often do we not stand up or speak out? How often does our agenda fill our day before we have time to think about children in some poor country or a neighbor down the street who is alone? Let it not happen to me. It's okay for them. Just don't get involved. And so the angry cries went out, "Crucify, crucify." No doubt Pilate, like Herod, had a choice. To some extent, he was accustomed to life or death choices. Thumbs up, thumbs down. He had the power of life and death in his hands, so no doubt this was not a hard thing for him. Still, an innocent man is an innocent man. And no crime was found on him. And yet it seemed that powerful forces were aligned against this man. Better not turn against him. Better not put up a fuss. Better not rankle the people. Better not create a situation when none has to be. And again the words rise up. Better one man than us all. It's life or death, after all. But they didn't understand, of course. And we don't always understand either. Touched by the darkness of the world, we feel like everything is an either-or choice, life or death. We do this, life goes well, or we risk everything and we do that. But really, that's not true. This Jesus is one who seems to be able to claim life and death, and death and life. Whoever wishes to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. The exalted must be humbled, the humbled will be exalted. Death and life. Die to self, live with Christ. Destroy the temple and it will be raised up, we say. Our greatest glory is our service to our awesome God. Our greatest power is in our ability to love and receive nothing in return. Our greatest strength is displayed not in our might, but in our bowing in prayer. Again and again, Jesus spoke, and they did not understand. They did not hear. We were too concerned about our lives, and we allowed his death. Yet in the end, we learn that even that is for us. He breathes his last, "Father, forgive them," he says, "for they know not what they do." Amen. Shadow of the Crucifixion. When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it. See who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." He said to the disciples, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scriptures, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. And Jesus had received the wine. He said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Shadow of Crucifixion. The tomb. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, and a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission. So he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloe, weighing about 100 pounds. He took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with spices and linen cloths according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified. And in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so because it was the Jewish day of preparation, the tomb was nearby. They laid Jesus there. Shadow of the tomb. In him was the light, and the light was the light of all people. The darkness of the tomb. This is the message that we have heard from him and proclaimed to you. In him was light and no darkness, and the darkness has not and shall not overcome it. As we go out into this world of shadows and darkness, may the light of Christ shine in us and through us for Jesus Christ. Amen. And now may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and abide upon us all, now and evermore. Amen.